Last June, Steve Feltham left his job selling burglar alarms in his native Dorset to pursue a lifelong ambition, to find the Loch Ness Monster.
I've always been fascinated in the subject. I've always been coming up for holidays looking for it. And I eventually decided, right, I want to do it full time, to just the things I've always daydreamed about doing full time, just actually follow my dreams, really.
And has it been hard for you?
Remarkably easy. Things have just fallen into place, making it easier and easier. And the more it goes on, the more established I get around the loch, the easier it becomes as well.
Adrian Shine, leader of the Loch Ness Project and consultant to the Loch Ness Monster exhibition.
The fact of the matter is that there is no scientific evidence to support the existence of the Loch Ness Monster. If there was, then we wouldn't have the world controversy that we have. What we do have is a great deal of anecdotal and eyewitness testimony to support the fact that strange things are seen in Loch Ness. And secondly, we can say that sometimes when we're using sonar, we do get strong sonar contacts that we don't understand.
Now, you've encountered Steve Feltham. Do you think he's wasting his time?
No, I don't think he's wasting his time. You've got to remember that the whole controversy arises through eyewitness testimony, what people see on the surface of the water. It doesn't arise through the sort of things that we do with our science underwater or with our sonars. It arises through records of things seen on the surface. Now, if Steve Feltham is here long enough, he is going to witness a lot of things happening on the surface of Loch Ness.
I will, as soon as I get up
there. Kiss a kiss, lover boy.
I'll have to practice it.
In every great adventure, the first step is always the hardest. Especially when you're relying on a 21-year-old mobile library to get you on the road.
Start the van! Quick! Steve, start the van!
You are just signing your life away.
After 18 months of planning, I'd retired at the age of 28.
Right.
No more mortgage and no more 9-to-5. Somebody once asked me, Steve, what do you really want to do with your life? I said, I'd like to find the Loch Ness Monster. No, that's just a dream. What do you seriously want to do? I just thought, why not? So I sold my house, left my job and set off.
It's up to you to get out there, prove it, and...
That's right,
yeah. Well,
what,
you haven't proved it, you haven't found it as yet, but there's no saying that you won't. Well, there's no saying that you will either, but...
Thanks, Mum.
The law of
averages
says I will.
Yeah.
Why?
So, what do you reckon about me going to find a Loch Ness Monster then?
Yeah, well... Oh, what do you reckon? All right, Steve.
Thanks, Dad.
If you find it, you'll make history.
That's right.
Apart from that,
But you can always rely on your mates, can't you?
You'll definitely have a good time trying. And if you find it, I'll definitely believe you.
Now, I reckon that a few people thought that I was mad, thought I was taking a long holiday and that I'd be back at the first sign of a Scottish winter, but I was serious, I was going for good. I was almost certain that eventually I'd find the Loch Ness Monster, but there was a chance that after a year or so I'd be disillusioned, my dreams could be shattered.
The journey's now got me to the centre of Shepton Mallet. Just had a run-in with a traffic warden, where I've parked, but as soon as I told him what I was doing, he turned out to be a lovely, lovely bloke. Chatting about how controversial the van is. But once you talk to them, once you explain what you're doing, and if you're pleasant to them and you don't sort of give them any trouble, they just go on their way there. So far, anyway. But then Shepton Mallet is the land of the rising hippie, isn't it?
Now, what I did know about this lifestyle was that it was all going to be very unpredictable. Anything could happen.
I can't go over the wall, can I? What?
I've just had the first of many major disasters in the van. There used to be a fireplace stood there. Now there's a fireplace in a bloody hell.
It's like a bloody black hole, this van, for things disappearing. So now my keys to the wind generator have gone down there, so I can't get the wind generator down to put the thing up properly. And now all my credit cards have disappeared down there as well, it would appear. Which could have been any time between now and yesterday. I've got about £1.10 to my name. I don't know if I've got enough diesel to get to Chester. But I need to get to Chester, go to the bank, put them straight on a few things in life. What a prat.
So many people, right, they say to me, "Ew, Whack, are you mad?" And I say, "Mad? No, Whack, I'm not mad. I'd be mad if I got to the age of 65 and realised there's more to life than working 9 to 5. Then I'd be mad. Then I'd be bloody livid.
What is life about? Life can't really be about working from the age of 16 to the age of 65 for somebody else, climbing your little way up the social ladder, then retiring and do the things you want to do. If you can find anything else to do with your time and support yourself in doing it, best of luck to you. Get a truck. Go and find yourself a monster. Baby, love's
what you make it. Park a mobile library in Chester on a Friday afternoon, 10 minutes before the banks close. You're joking.
Right, I'll run then.
Come with me a moment. As you know, I'm rushing to get to the bank to cancel all my cards. This pole, I lock this door with. Goes in there. I keep it in there, down the side of the thing, down there. Look. Can you see that down there? Do you know what that is? I think I'd better take a leisurely stroll around Chester.
Life was becoming more unpredictable all the time. Look who I bumped into in Chester.
So you're not a believer in the Loch Ness Monster?
No, I'm not. I don't think there's any scientific evidence for it. There've been a lot of ripples on the top of the water. There've been a few bumps pushing out of the water. But if there'd been a monster, I think we'd have sighted it, we'd have pictures of it, we'd have evidence of it, we'd have seen its eggs on the shore, we'd have seen its children swimming through the loch.
And what about if quite conclusive video proof was put in front of you, would you support the investigation?
Well, if it was conclusive, I'd support it. But I can't believe it would be conclusive, and I don't think anything that's been conclusive has been published up to now.
And what about the principle of somebody who's got dreams and... Myself, since about the age of 7, I've always been interested in this subject. What about the principle of somebody who's got dreams of those styled outside of the 9-to-5 existence? going off and following those dreams and trying to achieve.
I'm very much in favour of people following their dreams. What worried me about you when you met me in the street, you told me you'd sold your house to finance your dream. Well, I hope it comes off. I hope you find it and then you can buy 10 houses. But I hope it works out.
But the principle of selling the house to support it, you wouldn't agree with?
I wouldn't be worried to death. I would never do it. I'm not brave enough to do it. I'm not rash enough to do it.
Cheers then, right?
They don't even do diesel.
Come with me. Now, a very interesting thing has happened on this little slope going up here. I think I may have just run out of diesel. I have some more, but even so, there's the big job to come now of bleeding it all the way through the system. Just spit of it. I hate engines. Bloody hate them.
Thank you very much. Right road to Scotland. Lovely. Cheers then.
This is all very symbolic up here, I tell you. Hadrian's Wall. One time, a few years ago, this would have been crawling with Italians around here. All with some theory in mind that the Scots over there weren't that good to be getting on with, so keep them over there. In order to do that, they built this bloody great wall right the way across England. In the theory, that'll keep them all over there. As it happens, it did keep them all over there. There's a strange anti-social attitude to have. Strange, those Italians in those days. It's quite a major monument as well, hell of a thing. It just cuts across England like this. But although it's not now the border between England and Scotland, it's the mental border, really, isn't it? It's the crossing of Hadrian's Wall. You're up there in the north or you're down there in the south. I mean, look over there. See them coming, wouldn't you? You'd see them Scots coming trotting across there with their cudgels and their blooming. Not much else. And so the Italians would sit here and just wait, really. That Hadrian had a lot of strange ideas about life. Different times, I suppose. Scots and Italians get on nowadays, don't they? Normally. Look at the World Cup. Right, I've got a plan. What I'm going to do now is drive straight to Loch Ness. It's taken me 2 weeks to get to here. It's going to take me another 5 days, 6 days to get up to Loch Ness from here. I'm in Scotland. It's going to take me another 6 days at my rate to get up there. I can be up there by the morning if I go now. It's five to nine. So, straight on up there, I get some chips on the way. I was waiting for this phone box here to become vacant so that I can go and phone the people that I'm supposed to see on the way, tell them I won't be coming. But this is a plan. Right. I'll phone them later. You and me. Going to Loch Ness.
Once I crossed that border, I was desperate to get there. I could feel the pull of the loch. My heart was going like the clappers. The adrenaline was pumping. This time I didn't have to go back. It wasn't a holiday. This time I could stay for as long as I wanted. as long as it took.
This is it. And I am home. This, to me, is the culmination of years of dreaming. Years of dreaming about looking for this bloody thing. At last, I'm here full-time as a monster hunter, looking for the Loch Ness Monster. There's something in there, something unexplained, a question unanswered. It's my job, from now on, indefinitely, to try and answer that question. 9 o'clock in the morning it is, July 18th. That's when my biggest hunt starts. And that hunt's gonna go on for years. And what it holds, I have no idea. Not the lock, I've got a vague idea what the lock holds, but what the hunt holds. Years I've talked about this. Years. Now I'm a monster hunter.
Now, people around the lock, they see monster hunters come and go, but I wanted to win their respect. After all, it's their monster that I've come to find. But I knew that they didn't like talking to outsiders about it, and this was going to be a problem, because the eyewitness accounts of the monster from the local people are important pieces of evidence I had to collect. To make things more complicated, I intended to move around the lock. This meant being accepted into 3 different communities.
Thank you very much.
I also knew that I could expect a different reaction in, say, Dawes, to that in Drumna's Rocket. But for now, I'd arrived in Fort Augustus, found a nice spot at the end of the canal, and it was midsummer. Traditionally, a time when monster hunters are out in force.
Your boat are from the shore.
That's right, yeah, it's going to be a
blast of the van setting.
An angle that I'm not going to often see. It. Well, I suppose I will see it occasionally.
You see it every time you're out in the boat.
Yeah.
Now, I know that there are a few people who actually don't believe there is a monster in Loch Ness, but after studying the evidence, I do. And I'm not the only one. Doug McFarland and his family have been coming to the Loch in their spare time for years now, and I jumped at the opportunity to go out hunting with them. Over the years, Doug's collected an impressive amount of evidence, a lot of eyewitness reports, and some fascinating sonar contacts that he's recorded himself.
Passed along the side of it, they turned round for a look at it, it swung away and then it submerged a bit and then surfaced again and then dived completely down there.
Doug is like most people who get involved in the hunt. He has a consuming interest in the mystery, but he's also got a full-time job. So obviously the amount of time he can spend at the lock is very limited. I know how frustrating that can be. I've been a part-time monster hunter for the last 10 years. It's not often that monster hunters get together, but when we do, there's nothing we enjoy more than spending a few hours debating the various pieces of evidence, especially the sonar contacts. They're just so debatable.
Motoring along and that had come up and went down, I never noticed it because I'm messing about.
Yeah.
So these are more like sort of fish. This looks fairly substantial echo of some sort. The one that the Americans liked as a single target that said was a whopper is that one there.
There's one solid.
There's one solid object and you can see the side and return effects on it.
Yeah.
Of course, the big problem with the Loch Ness Monster is that some people just don't take it seriously.
Loch Ness, on which the eyes of the world are focused, the reputed haunt of a prehistoric monster or monsters, and the newly found adventure ground of modern Gullivers. Mr. Witherall, the big game hunter and his party, who have been hot on the trail of the monster for some time, set out from Foyers to comb the lake. Meanwhile, a specially organized movie tone expedition, consisting of a full big game camera crew unit, sets out from London, armed to the teeth.
Now, there's no harm in having a joke, But since 1933, the monster's never really got over this kind of treatment.
The leader of our gallant crew has already taken up his position. He hears something. He sees something. He's going to shoot it.
But now we monster hunters might have the last laugh. Some very respectable people are getting involved.
See, this was given to me yesterday. £2 million probe into Loch Ness secrets. It's an operation being mounted next summer and for 4 years running after that, costing £2 million, organised by the scientific community to actually see if they can get some results in here, do some scientific tests. It's the actual person, one of the co-directors of organising this whole thing, is Nick Witchell, the BBC newsreader. It's going to be called Project Urquhart. They haven't as yet approached me to see if I'll rent them my mobile library, but I'm sure if they approach me.
20 years ago, I built a wooden hut in a field near Urquhart Castle. It's gone now. It was finally blown away by the gales a few years ago. And I spent just 5 months living in my little wooden hut at the age of 17 or 18. And I had my camera and my binoculars, and I was getting up at the crack of dawn and peering out, and I never saw anything. But I know how tough it can be to sit and watch and keep your concentration up, and how discouraging it can be when day after day or week after week you don't see anything. But when you talk to somebody who has had a clear sighting and who is patently honest, it is awfully difficult to dismiss that testimony as being mistaken or being the figment of somebody's imagination.
Until you see it, you don't believe that there's anything there, because I didn't really believe there was anything there. But now that I've seen it, there's something there.
There's too many people over the years seen something, too many creditable people, and you know, that's, they can't all be lying. They can't all be making up something.
Been spending the day here painting the van, camouflaging it, disguising it as a Winnebago, transforming from a hippie truck to a respectable caravanette. And an ITN news crew turn up to go out and do some other work on salmon poaching in the loch here, who've previously heard about what I'm doing and made initial tentative inquiries to sort of do something in the future with ITN. David Chater, it was the same name I've heard before on the news. He said, don't bother getting involved with the BBC if you get a result. Don't get involved with them, because all they do is sit in offices. This is my brother, helping me paint the van. So happens that, as I got a camera, he seems to be doing most of the painting this fair, but it all falls into place.
What about the camouflage job we've done on my van then? Do you reckon that's done the trick?
Well, you're happier about it, so obviously it has, but I think the locals will give you more respect once you've been up here a winter still looking for it, as opposed to what colour you've painted your van. But you feel better, so.
What do you reckon to being up here for a winter? Do you reckon that's going to be hard?
It's going to be hard, cold, you'll have to sort out the fire. But I don't know how much you'll actually be able to achieve during the winter, because it's going to be dark, wet and cold.
What my brother said about winter was certainly food for thought. I wasn't sure how bad it would be. How would the van handle the cold? And for that matter, how would I handle it? He was right about the locals. If I survived the winter on the side of the loch, they'd start to accept me as a permanent fixture. But whatever did happen, it was going to be exciting. As Martin set off for the long drive back to Dorset, I found myself almost looking forward to winter. I might have given up on the 9-to-5 lifestyle, but this adventure still has to be financed. I made some money from selling my house, but there's not much profit in that anymore. And what I did get wasn't going to last very long, so I needed to come up with another form of income. This is my answer. Little models of Nessie sat on a rock. I call them Nessie Ceres, for obvious reasons. They keep me in food and diesel, but that's just about it. Now, I can sell as many as I can make, but they take ages. Anyway, the process is simple. You model them, you bung them in the oven, and they're nearly ready.
I'm busy here making these things. The last thing you need to do, right, is when you've cooked them, you need to then glue them to the rock. I've run out of the Yoo-hoo glue that I normally use, so I've started using super glue. Only problem is, I've stuck my fingers together. Look.
Oh. 2 miles, 1001, falling. Ronald's Way, southwest by south 6, continuous slight rain, 2 miles, 1004, falling. And Malin Head, east 3, intermittent slight rain, 16 miles, 999, falling slowly. And that's the end of the shipping forecast.
That means it's 6:15. You add to this a nice red sunrise, reflecting on the water and...
That's annoying, but interesting, isn't it? You stand here watching the lock in the morning, waiting for a sighting. Up something pops. And what is it? It's a seal. This seal has been reported. I've heard people have seen it in Urquhart Bay, further up. Yesterday somebody came along and told me it was just round in Inch Bay. So at least it identifies that there is a seal in here at the moment. There's something, I suppose.
Apart from monster hunters, summer at Loch Ness means tourists from all over the world. For them, this is Scotland. The Highlands, a kilted piper, and a chance to see a monster. They love it. The ones that get me are the whirlwind tour of Scotland variety. I've seen them pull up, jump out, take a photo, and away to the next attraction, all in less than 2 minutes flat. Now they know why they've come here, and I know why they're here. But when you ask them...
Pardon? Do you think it's in there? No?
It's a good tourist gimmick, that's about all. Too many scientific exhibitions had a crack at it, and they haven't come up with anything. There would be more positive evidence by now after, 200 or 300 years?
I was just looking across at that, an angle. You know, when you said you looked for this angle, don't you?
Aye.
Yeah. Seen this big black hump, you know, above the waves.
Aye.
And I would say the waves at the time would be 5 feet anyway, and it was breaking, you know, really. Worse than that. Oh, God, I see it. First of all, I sort of was an upturned boat, you know, the back of it.
Aye.
No, can't be. Anyway, see, this thing came moving across slowly. There were two off-duty nurses.
Did they see it as well?
One of them seen it, but she didn't want to say anything to... She seen exactly the same as me, but
aye.
She didn't want to say anything, you see, to her friend. But she might know I've been looking, you know. The visibility was really bad.
So that was probably 85, wasn't it?
About 84, 85, I think it would be.
I think, aye.
You remember that? Where are you from?
I live around the loch now.
Oh, do you?
Aye.
Oh, you're on the loch side, do you?
Aye, all the time. Monster hunting.
Oh, are you? Oh, with this? Is this you?
Aye.
Oh, see. Where do you stay? You go up and down, or?
Yep.
One of the first things that I'd done when I arrived at the loch was to ask a few people if I could park on their lochside land. It didn't take long to establish half a dozen choice spots around the loch. Some were obviously going to be more convenient than others. The Doors Inn, for instance, has its own outside tap. Very handy. There's something about the pace of life up here. They seem to have it just about right. The people in the villages are friendly to visitors, but I was still feeling a bit like a newcomer. After being around for a couple of months, it must have been obvious to the locals that I wasn't just another passing tourist. I think they were starting to accept me, and I was now hoping that as time rolled on, this could only get better.
Through the fact that it's there, but not so that it's captured, so keeping people on purpose.
I like to think it's there.
Right.
But I don't know. I love the story of it.
People were starting to trust me enough to talk to me about their experiences of the loch, the strange things that they've seen in the waters. Big animals that they could neither identify nor explain. When I set off from Dorset, I might have been following some kind of dream, but I set myself two practical, serious aims. Firstly, the obvious one, I wanted to film whatever it is that's been seen in this loch since St. Columbus first reported it in 565 AD. Secondly, but just as important, I wanted to record recent sightings as and when I heard of them. People aren't aware of just how often these animals are being seen. Maybe if I can do this, in the long run, the whole Loch Ness controversy can be lifted out of the silly season category. Only then will the subject get the respect it deserves.
Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning, Margaret.
How are you today?
Oh, same as ever.
Not so early today, not so early.
Well, I'm Margaret McLennan. I live at Doors on the shores of Loch Ness. I ran the local post office in Doors and I saw this strange, strange creature. It was fascinating, it was exciting, it was like a crocodile. And it was doggedly working its way up the loch against the way the water was coming in. The water was just gently coming in towards the house. A sort of greyish colour with blotches, brown, black blotches on it. And I really took time and watched it and thought, felt it was being propelled by flippers. It wasn't bobbing up and down. Couldn't see a head, just this long thing just steadily working its way to wherever it lives. I found it exciting because it was different to anything I'd ever seen before.
And it's well accepted in the village then that there's...
I think most people in the village know there is something in the water, something very large.
I've walked out to Tor Point now, to quite a remote part of the loch. So getting round here, I can sit quietly and I can watch a quiet stretch of water, hopefully with some result. It's bloody lovely, I tell you, it's lovely. I wouldn't fancy being down here in the middle of winter though, because the waves. So you got all that back up there. Right. Yeah, 22 odd miles of loch stretching away down there. And this is like the point sticking in at this end where the waves are going to be crashing over here in the winter. God, it's going to be terrible. Quite like winter, man.
Tell me, what do you reckon to living on the side of Loch Ness then, eh? And in dog language, that is arr, 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 was saying then was, I asked her, have you seen anything in the loch swimming around out here that you can't explain? She said, well, on one occasion she did, and when then I went on to ask her what did it look like, and she said, well, it was just this low, dark hump travelling through the water just along over there. Very interesting, Ted. And...
Alright, so we'll stop by here. You don't have to cook tonight. Because, yeah, you can eat with us.
Lovely. Excellent.
Of course.
Well, it's nice to meet you anyway. So.
Yeah, because I'm going to talk to you, you know, later. And yeah. I have to give you, you know, my name card.
Yeah.
And I have to clarify myself suddenly popping up, you know, and just giving weird questions and things like that. I'm sorry for that. Yeah. I'll be back, definitely.
Lovely.
Yeah, thanks
a lot.
See
you again.
Yeah.
Bye.
Japanese TV.
それではここまでに続きまして東京、ニューヨーク、そしてロンドンからニュースを詳しくお伝えしていきます。
そうです、日本でも有名なネッシー、いるのかいないのかはっきり決着をつけようとスコットランドのネス湖に行ってきました。早速 VTR をご覧ください。
One day you sat there minding your own business looking for monsters.
スティーブ・フェルトハムさん28歳、今年の6月イギリス南西部から家も車も売り払ってネス湖にやってきました。目的はもちろんネッシー探しです。
When I decided that alarm installing wasn't the sort of work for me,
and before you know it, you're an overnight success in Japan.
The weather's driven me back into my van now. There's a load of drizzle. Autumn's really in the air. You can feel there's a chill on everything, and there's a freshness in the air. You know, even when the sun's out, it's warmish. There's still this freshness in the air, which wasn't there a week ago. But I'm down at Fort Augustus. They collected my post. I think it's clearing up a bit, actually.
Here's something I'd like you to have a look at, right? It's been out there for a quarter of an hour now. Well, no, half an hour. Let's have a closer look now. Now, look, that bit of debris there. And people have the nerve to say that somebody's mistaken something like that floating around out there for something sticking out of the water and looking around and something animate living and moving around. Shooting through the water at back maybe 15 feet long. Or, you know, it's not, is it? It's not, you can't mistake that as anything but a bit of driftwood. Bloody obvious what that is.
Two thousand years ago, Doubting Thomas said he didn't believe. Well, I did see the Loch Ness Monster. I saw it up by Altmer Gelvin, the towards Invermoriston. We were two of us, 25 years ago, we were above the loch and we watched it for 10 or 15 minutes and we watched it meander around. It's the models, the plastic models that they have on the loch with the four flippers, the long neck and the long tail, to me that is what I saw.
Yeah?
Exactly what I saw. Now, honestly, God strike me dead if I tell you a lie. That's what I saw. But of course, when you tell the story to people, they say, ah, he's at it.
So yeah. Local people just shut up about it, don't they?
They don't say anything. Oh. If you have a drink and you're saying to one of your mates, I saw the monster, he just sniggers. If he hasn't seen it, but if he's seen it, or he'll say to you, ah, you've had one too many. But if he's seen it, he just gives you a knowing wink and says, that's right, that's what we saw, you know? And they all have seen the same thing.
That's
right. Well, do you mind if I get on my fishing? I want to get half a dozen salmon
you
today.
Go and get your fish.
Thank you very much.
I'll find this monster.
Yes.
Doing a little bit of experimental cooking in here today. On the left we have haggis, tatties, a neep. A neeps. Got me haggis on the go here, me potato here. Didn't have any turnip for it, so I've been up to the inn, borrowed a takeaway portion of turnip from the pub. Handy thing, the fact the pub's next door. So I'm going to have haggis, neeps and tatties. My haggis has been bubbling away for 10 minutes. My tatties weren't lit. No, it's cold, that water. Oh well. I don't know what it is, something that makes some days just, for some reason, better than other days for monster hunting.
Be earning. Who is the strongest? Who is the best? Who holds the aces, the east or the west? This is the crap our children are learning.
Nice in the winter, lovely in the winter, everybody kept telling me. You'll love it up here in the winter.
I've got a cold.
Now the satellite's confused, 'cause on Saturday night, the airwaves were full of compassion and light. And his silicon heart warmed to the sight of a billion candles burning.
Could be something. There's like a neck stuck up over there. It's getting closer and closer now. That's the sort of thing that is very deceptive. As it happens, today it's just a tree trunk. But tomorrow it might not be. When it reaches the beach, I'm gonna saw it up and teach it a lesson. Late yesterday evening on the news, on the radio, they were giving a lot of storm warnings and flood warnings. That's that gate that I normally saw me wood up, and there's normally another 10 foot before you reach the water. It's risen up about 5 or 6 feet in depth overnight. There's gonna be no shortage of driftwood, that's for one thing, for me fire.
It's about 3 o'clock in the morning, I would guess now.
It's like my fillings are getting rattled loose now. This wind generator's going bloody crazy tonight. It's like, you have to weigh up whether or not to leap out there and take the thing down in the howling gale that's blowing out there. It's probably about a force 8 tonight, I think I heard earlier on. I thought I'd share that with you. This is a Cayley that the McLennans are getting together to raise some money for the Kintail Museum, which is the McLennan Museum across on the west coast. So I volunteered to do up the poster, and then we're going to get them put up. So this Cayley is going to take place next Saturday, and it's going to be a bit of a hoolie. It's going to be a hoorialach, which means a bit of a wingding, apparently.
Survived the worst of the winter. I'd been living on the side of the loch for 6 months, and I can honestly say that this place is now my home.
Trying to do a decent pan with the video camera, but the truth of the matter is that it's 6 o'clock in the morning and I'm just back from the McLennan and Cayley, and this is the time though, isn't it, if you're going to get a monster sighting, right? If you're going to see something big and mysterious swimming around in these waters, this is the time where you're going to see it. Stands to reason, doesn't it? Crack of dawn. Still thing. And I mean, if anything popped up out there for the next, what's it called? Then get a sighting, wouldn't you?
David Bellamy, the flamboyant TV naturalist, was called to Loch Ness to examine the latest find, a series of large footprints along the shore, and he's linking it to the monster.
That's Loch Ness, and this is certainly a footprint of what we call a monster. Look, three toes, slight webbing. Now, the three toes says to me, you know, one of the great dinosaurs, a claw on the end, and you can actually see how the animals move that started to rub the shingle. If only this had been sand, I mean, or fat, that is untrue, because you see it's quite tough shingle, and actually some of the tissue of whatever passed this way, the skin's come off. I should be immensely careful with that, because in that skin would be cells. that is probably what his mates will say.
Probably.
I didn't know it was the police
and they said they could have been hairy.
Excuse me.
I think it's just taking the mickey myself.
Yeah?
Yep.
Not too impressed then?
Not really, no. Certainly not doing the subject any good.
So what's your conclusion then, after 30 years of...
I hope it's there and I hope we never bloody well find it, because if we do, they'll do something nasty to it, won't they? I mean, what would happen if they actually found the thing?
Yeah, but then again, say tomorrow I got a bit of film or something out here. There'd be no nearer to actually getting the thing out and exploiting it, would there? It'd just be evidence to say, no, yes, it's in there, but the technology's not here to actually get it out, is it?
But if one had, they could have got a dirty great net and scrape down the whole thing and pull it up.
Luckily, bylaws stop that, don't they? Can't.
But, the thing that really worries me is what would they do to it? I mean, I was going on a dinosaur hunt to the middle of... Africa, because there is this amazing animal that lives in the river there, I think.
Up in the Congo, isn't it?
Yeah, and I thought, what? And there again, like Peter Scott, you see, Peter said that if we don't give it a name, we can't protect it under CITES, can we? Hadn't done the rhinoceros much good.
I guess I get to keep these, I suppose. What a circus. I would love, when they were doing all their bits and pieces, I would love to have seen the back just break the surface out here and just swim past and just sort of... I wonder what they'd have made of that. April the 1st.
Some sightings have more credibility than others. There was one witness that I needed to talk to.
Hello.
Hello. I'd like to speak to Father Gregory, please.
See if I can get him for you.
Okay.
But would he talk to me?
Okay, Father. Okay. He'll come down and see you just now, but I don't think it's for an interview.
Okay.
But you'll come, Dad.
Lovely.
Good afternoon.
Father Gregory, I recognise you instantly.
I'm very sorry. I've had this kind of thing for years, and I've called it off now, you know.
Have you?
Yes. Photographed about the monster. I've just had enough of it, you know.
Have you really?
Yes, if you don't mind.
But yours is such a classic sighting.
Yeah, well, it wasn't as good as some of the others.
No?
Oh, no, I only saw the neck. I never saw the body of the thing.
Yeah.
Yes.
There was this...
There's a man down in London who saw it with me.
This is right, yes.
Yes,
I remember.
And Mr. Roger Pugh. Yeah, but nobody seems to have bothered him very much. Just because I've got the what they call a man on the cloth and put a religious habit on, they all go for you, you see.
That's right.
Because they think you haven't got no kind of extra grind. Yeah.
Gives it respect.
Yes.
Aye. So would you not do a piece about, just a small piece about roughly what you've seen, quickly what you've seen?
No, I don't mind recording something, but I don't want to be filmed again. You don't mind?
No?
Yeah. Unless I see a fresh sighting and I don't mind helping the cause then.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, well, I shall hope you have another sighting.
Yes.
Yes. And other monks around, no?
No, there's no one really, just at present.
No.
The ones that really had saw it have passed away. They know whether it's true or not now in the next world. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, it's true enough.
Yes.
It's true enough.
Come on, I'll give you a short thingy bow. If it helps your cause, I'll do it.
Thank you.
We were standing on the jetty, looking across the water, which was quite calm. There were no boats about at all to to confuse the issue, because you sometimes you see a whale, or sometimes a wash, you could think it was something. Now, we were suddenly arrested by the sight of a tremendous kind of churning up of the water to our right, about 300 yards away in the bay. And a second or so afterwards, we saw this great neck 5 feet above the water moving along quite slowly towards the middle of the lock for about 20 seconds. Then it went down in a sideways motion. We never saw the famous humps, but just this great neck moving along. Yes, so yeah. We undoubtedly saw Nessie. Yes.
Mm.
Yes.
Well, there's definitely some.
Definitely something there, I think. The evidence is too clear and startling from so many people. Why in this particular lock should there be so many people seeing this and not on other locks? Why is there not Loch Lomond or some other, where there are visitors of some kind? If it's an illusion, as people say, it's an illusion. Now, why doesn't it happen in other locks?
That's right.
No, I think the evidence, accumulated evidence is too strong. Hmm.
Thank you very much.
Yes, good.
Thank
I
you
hope
very
that
much,
helps.
Father. It will help.
Yes.
It will, thank you.
Yes.
Some people, they come along here, some people did it today, they come along and they start talking to you all about what you're doing and things. And then they say, but are you mad? They like ask you if you're mad. Now, what I'm doing here, to me, I don't fully understand how somebody working in the 9-to-5 in society, going to work each day of the week, 40 hours a week, doing something they don't want to do to finance their spare time doing things they do want to do. I don't know how people in that situation can say to me, are you mad? Because, like, this is the only responsibility I've got. This is the thing that I believe in passionately, the hunt for this thing out here. They say, don't you get bored? How do you get bored? You sit here looking across this. You can't. No.
First impressions look like, might just look like a pub beer garden. But, in fact, this is not just any old pub beer garden, this is the Foyers Hotel beer garden. A location from which, back in the history of monster hunting, I'll tell you, back in 1960, Tim Dinsdale, the father of all monster hunters, his first visit up here, out of curiosity, he spent 6 days staying in this hotel here behind me, and on his very last day, he was out and about, first thing, and that's when he got that famous sequence of film where there's the object swimming off across the bay. He's saying, is this bay here that the thing's swimming across?
Analysis by the RAF is this is the most impressive film evidence to date. Put it all together, the film, the photographs, the sonar contacts. No single piece of evidence is yet conclusive. But when you add to all of that the thousands of eyewitnesses who've reported seeing massive living animals in here, then you're starting to build up a huge case for the existence of a small colony of very big creatures living in this lock.
I've tried to give you a glimpse of my dream and how I chased it for a year. What I'm trying to say is, this isn't just about hunting for a monster, but about having a dream and following it. It doesn't matter if people say you're mad. If you don't go for it, one day you may say, well, I wish I'd done that when I had the chance. If you don't follow your dreams, the only person who loses is you.
And some people say, ha! Are you mad?